So welcome to the 13th Annual Cheney Lecture. We are delighted to have all of you here. We're delighted to have Dr. Phil Meadows here. There's the bio of Dr. Meadows is in your booklet and about our presenter. But beyond what's said there, I just want to let you know, Phil and I met back in 2010. He was actually one of my examiners for my PhD thesis. And here we call it a defense. Over in England, it's a viva. And he was extremely tough. Our relationship has been much more grace-filled.
I thought I was being nice to him.
Phil is an absolutely wonderful man. He is not only a scholar, he is a passionate Christian. He is one of the most spirit-filled people I know. And I can say all of that right now because he's sitting over there. It has been truly an honor and a privilege for me to know him over these years and for our relationship to have deepened over the last couple. And I am absolutely delighted that you're here. And so I'm excited. To kind of get us engaged in going, I want to give just a short devotion before we begin. And I'm going to read out of Mark chapter 12. Later, the leader sent some Pharisees and supporters of Herod to trap Jesus into saying something for which he could be arrested. "Teacher," they said, "we know how honest you are. You are impartial and don't play favorites. You teach the way of God truthfully. Now tell us, is it right to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Should we pay them or shouldn't we?" Jesus saw through their hypocrisy and said, "Why are you trying to trap me? Show me a Roman coin and I'll tell you." When they handed it to him, he asked, "Whose picture and title are stamped on it?" "Caesar's," they replied. "Well then," Jesus said, "give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar and give to God what belongs to God." His reply completely amazed them. So I wanted to lead off with that scripture passage because it's one of the key ingredients, I think, to being a Christian. Now, a lot of times we've taken this passage and we've said this means we can separate our religious and our civic lives. We can have our public sphere and how we interact with the state, giving to Caesar what's Caesar's, and we can have our private personal relationship with God and give to God what is God's. But that's not what Jesus says here at all. Interestingly enough, he says, "In whose image is this coin made?" In other words, if any of the powers and principalities of this world want to take hunks of metal out of the ground and put their own images on it, go ahead and give it back to them. That's fine. But in whose image, who is made in the image of God? And so the implication is, whatever this world has to offer, that's the world's. That's fine. What we always have to remember whenever we're dealing with anything in our lives, anything at all, from the way we make our decisions to how we use our resources and to how we spend our time and how we interact with one another, we have to remember that we are to offer to God what is made in the image of God, which is our very selves. And so I want to just lead off with that idea as we begin to look at discipleship, as we look at what makes a faith-formed community and what makes for the environment for true Christian growth in grace and power of the Holy Spirit. So just keep that in the back of your mind as we go through. We as Christians are to give to God what is in the image of God. So, let us pray. Lord God Almighty, we thank you for the opportunity to gather here. We thank you that even before the Cheney Lecture was created 13 years ago, you knew that we would be here. We thank you that your Spirit always goes before us. We thank you that your Spirit enlivens and draws us closer to you and to one another. We thank you that through the presence and the power of your Holy Spirit in our lives, you give us new life and an ability to be even more than we were born as, but what we were created to be and then recreated to be. We thank you for this, Lord, and we pray that in the power and the presence of your Holy Spirit here throughout this day, you would anoint Phil, you would anoint us to receive what he has to say, and that you would enable this to be a time not only of learning, but of worship and of fellowship, so that through this entire event, we can more fully and more completely offer to you what is in your image and likeness. We pray this in your most holy name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Steve. I should say, Dr. Bruns, you're a lot more formal here, aren't you, than we are in England? I have been teaching in the area of discipleship, evangelism, mission for longer than I care to remember. And one of the sermons that Mr. Wesley prepared, wrote, and maybe preached was entitled The General Spread of the Gospel. And in it, he is asking a really important question. And it's a bit of a conundrum. But let me step back and just sort of explain the background before getting to the question itself that he's wrestling with. So Wesley believes that we have the most awesome good news in the world. Amen. See, now, I thought you Americans were also more responsible. We do. We have an amazing gospel. You know, the good news of the saving love of God that pursues us and reaches out to us, no matter who we are or how deeply we have sunk into the mire, to rescue us, and not just to rescue us, but to fully embrace us, pour his Spirit in us, change us from the inside out, so that we, like Jesus, can cry out, Abba, Father, and walk with him day by day, intimately in his protection, his providence, his power, his purpose, to make life all that it's meant to be, for his praise and glory and our blessing and joy. And that is good news. Yes? We have an amazing gospel. What's more, Wesley believes that everybody in the world, every human being, is created to hear this gospel and find it to be good news. Right? We are all made in the image of God, though it may be marred. You know, it may be broken. But notwithstanding how marred or broken it is, the Holy Spirit is at work in the hearts and lives of all people. You know, we Wesleyans call it prevenient grace. You know, that which goes before is at work in all people to help lead them and open them up to the good news of Jesus. So when they hear it, they're capable of hearing it and responding to it, you know. So here is Wesley's conundrum. If the gospel is that kind of good news, and if every person is created to hear that good news and as good news and empowered to respond to that good news, then why is it that not yet all the world has become Christian? Or to bring it down to a more local question, how is it that some people can hear the gospel and not receive it as good news? You know? Not respond to it, not become followers of Jesus. You know, his question is, what is it? What is the grand stumbling block to the general spread of the gospel? What is it that gets in the way? Now, he's not asking this question because he is somehow becoming disillusioned with the power of the gospel. Far from it. He has and is, when he writes this, seeing people's lives dramatically and wonderfully changed by this good news, day by day. People, by thousands. You know, he's living in the middle of a revival, a transatlantic revival. So he's not asking it because he's disillusioned, you know, with the gospel, nor is he asking it because he's wondering whether they've got their methods of proclaiming the gospel right. I mean, frankly, they don't even think about methods in that sense of proclaiming the gospel. They just do it all the time and in all places, wherever they can, you know, marketplaces, gravestones, you know, sometimes in churches where they were allowed to preach the gospel, you know, in the fields, you know. They just did it everywhere with their neighbors. So it's not a question of method either. I think he's asking it because he's just not satisfied. He desires everyone that hears the gospel to receive it as that and be, have their lives transformed. That's why he's asking the question, what is the grand stumbling block? What is that which gets in the way? Now, Wesley's answer to that question is very simple, but it is profoundly challenging, I think, for all of its simplicity. And here's what he says. The grand stumbling block to the general spread of the gospel is the lives of Christians. Just for a minute or so, with the person sat next to you, ask this question, or talk about this. What do you think he means by that, and do you agree? All right? What do you think he means by that, and do you agree? Just with the person sat next to you. I'm going to make you work today. I'm not doing all that. So, who wants to give me some of your thoughts? What do you think? Do you agree? What does he mean? Yeah. So we might talk about a God of love, but our lives don't reflect the reality of that. Yeah, just talk. Any other thoughts? Because we don't embody the truth of what we profess, you know. That's a question of authenticity, isn't it? You know, somebody can say that they really believe something, but unless it actually changes the way that they actually live, it doesn't really amount to very much, does it? No. Yeah. Any other thoughts? I'm just asking for simple thoughts here. You know. Not. This is not essay assignment time.
I think that the good news is just proclaim the good news, and it doesn't have an embodiment, then it just gets kind of relegated with all the other ideas in the world, and
yeah,
can be taken or leave.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you know, probably at some point in your studies, somebody's going to talk to you about postmodernism, right? Have you had this yet? Okay, so, you know, one of the... guilty? So one of the conditions of post-modernity, you know, is this idea that really, that truth is relative, isn't it? You know, truth is relative. And one person's truth might not be another person's truth, and we can all believe whatever we want to believe. And so, you know, you talk about this God of love, but, and that's okay. And it might be okay for you, but you know, and that's always, and some people have reflected on that and it's led me to reflect deeper on what we mean by truth. And what, when Jesus talks about being the truth and the way and the life and so on. See, I think the issue is not just about truth. It's important that we know the truth and that we speak the truth. The question, but I think the question that is at the heart of postmodern culture is not what's true, because that's already problematic. It's what is real. Right? What is real? The big question is not you proving the truth of the existence of God. What people want to know is the God that you speak about real? Can we, encounter this reality who you speak of? Can we encounter this reality of a God of love who transforms our life, according to the good news that you speak of? And how do we encounter this God? So there's all these different narratives, these different stories, about how to live your life out there, right? Competing for one another. The question is, how do we connect the story that we tell with the absolute, unshakable reality and power of God? How do we connect that story with the reality? Let me suggest it's this: your life. You. The way you live, becomes the semantic glue that connects what you say about God with the reality of God's presence and life-transforming power. See what I mean? Any other thoughts before I press on? Just reflections about that. The grand stumbling block. So, we could sort of parse that thought out in a number of different ways, couldn't we? Hypocrisy. People who say one thing, and it's not just that they don't then embody it, they actually can do the exact opposite. Right? People who say they love that really hate. Hypocrisy. Moral failure. All kinds of things. But what if it's not just about the form of life that we have and the way that we live, as such? What if Wesley's getting at something all that, but even deeper than that? What if Wesley is saying people will encounter the reality of God in the lives of Christians when their lives are full of, let's say, joy. Joy. Now, if you were to talk to some of my close spiritual friends, they would be very happy to say, "Oh, yeah, he can be a real miserable Christian this way." I can complain about everything, and usually it's the church, which is a double whammy for this issue, right? Yet the psalmist says, in the presence of God there is fullness of joy. There's a lot of darkness, depression, brokenness, sadness, in the world. Where does this joy come from? Joy is a fruit of the Spirit. What if what Wesley is saying is that actually, fundamentally, the real issue is the presence and the work of the Holy Spirit, in our lives, that produces the fruit of the Spirit in our lives, a people of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, humility, self-control, and that when we have that, It's the X factor, Do you have that over here? You're not admitting, okay? It's almost intangible. I'm a convert, and I can remember when I first started getting mixed up with Christians. I was interested as a scientist in the things that they said, the truth that they spoke, etc. But when I got amongst them, the big thing that rose up in my heart was this: they've got something that I want. you know, a quality of spirit, you know, of life that's just attractive, appealing. You know, I know they're not perfect. You know, I've seen them in other contexts. But there's just something there, you know, something different. Maybe that's what Wesley is talking about. If he is right, and I think that he is right, if Wesley is right, then what he's really saying is that ultimately the key to mission and even evangelism is not our projects, our programs, our strategies, etc. It is our discipleship. It's a discipleship issue. And he goes on in that same sermon to say this. In general, it seems the kingdom of God. Now, when Wesley speaks about the kingdom of God, he takes he likes the way that Paul puts it in Romans, I think, isn't it? The kingdom of God is righteousness and peace and joy, right? In the Holy Spirit. Righteousness and peace, reigning in our hearts. You know, where that is set up, it will silently increase both in our lives and spread from heart to heart, house to house, town to town, nation to nation, and around the world. This is how the gospel... Notice he doesn't first say mouth to ear, right? It's heart to heart. Now, incorporated in that... But what he... Notice, let me just pause for a minute on where he says that. It will silently increase. Silently increase. Because I think that there's the potential for misunderstanding here. I can never remember how this goes exactly, but you know that there's a famous saying, isn't there? St. Francis, how is it? He says, you know, proclaim the gospel always and... use words when you have to, or use words if necessary. Well, first of all, it's very doubtful that Francis actually ever said that, although it's a saying attributed to him. I mean, after all, he founded a movement of preachers, right? So he is definitely not saying that the best thing we can do is just live good lives and we don't have to then actually communicate the gospel with our lips, right? What Wesley, I think, is doing here is reflecting, it's a sign of the times. Remember I said he's in a time of revival. Revivals are noisy, right? Loud, spectacular. What he's doing here, and Wesley, he loves revival, and, you know, he prays for revival. But for Wesley, that would be the extraordinary way that the gospel is spread. Remember the title of this sermon, is the general spread of the gospel. What he's interested in is the ordinary way, the way that God spreads the gospel, you know, always, with or without revival, right? So when the noise has died down, when the clamor has died down, when the spectacle has died down, the question is, what do you have left? Do you have, you know, a people whose lives are actually transformed through whom the gospel continues to be spread heart to heart, life to life? And I had a doctoral student wrote a thesis on a kind of theology of revival and looking back over church history, and he describes revival as God's spirit pulse in history. You know, we're not meant to live in perpetual revival mode, right? Like a heart beats so that blood can flow through the body continuously. You know, the point of revival is to create a wholly transformed people who can then pass that life on to others and pass that life on to others, you know. Make sense so far? It's not rocket science. There won't be any of that today. Interestingly, in this sermon, one of the things that exercises him is how on earth are we going to bear witness to and convert Muslims? Interestingly, how are we going to do that? And without going into all of that, His answer is, it has to be this, you know, the life and witness of Christians. So, one of the things that I think when I read through the tradition of Wesleyan theology and spirituality, what I see coming together there is a connection between the importance of pursuing a deep personal spirituality, a deep personal walk with God that then connects with and becomes missional by nature. And so there's a strong connection between these two, you know, spirituality and mission. Though they're very easily divided. You know, they're often divided in local churches, you know. You have the kind of spirituality worship team or whatever over here and the mission team over here, and, you know, they may not talk to one another for various reasons, you know. Or the prayer group here, and, you know. And in some ways, it might reflect the fact that some people are, you know, I've heard, you know, that they're more contemplative or active, you know. And it happens at denominational levels. So, you know, you have whole kind of denominational departments of mission and whatnot, and then of, you know, spirituality and worship. And how those things come together and the inseparability of those two things is often lost. If I put it as simply as I can, God's mission, let me summarize it very quickly. God's mission of love it courses through history from creation to new creation, from the fall to the restoration of all things. And God is moving through history, through the power, what he's doing through the power of his Spirit and through the redeeming work of Jesus. That, you know, he's transforming all things, and in the end he will make all things new. And we are in the midst of this. We, if you like, one image you might use is to say, you know, we are caught up. We are to be caught up in this missional flow of God's presence and work throughout history. And we are caught up in it, not first as participants in God's mission, you know, doing things with him or for him. We are caught up in God's mission first as recipients, right? God first needs to fill our lives and transform our hearts, you know? And when he has taken us up and forgiven us and filled us and empowers us and transforms us, then we become participants in what he wants to do in the lives of others. Then what he is doing in us overflows, right, into our life in the world and our relationships with other people. Now there's a danger of separating what it means to be a recipient and a participant. Many just want to be recipients, you know. Let me have it, Lord. Bless me, Lord, you know. They never give a thought to the reason why God might do that. The reason that God blesses his people, whether it's the people of Israel or the church or you or I, the reason that we are blessed is to be a blessing. You really want to be blessed? Open yourself up to be a blessing so that God's love and power can flow through you. People who, you know, often find themselves not blessed. I often say, well, look, you need to just get out there and start living that life, and then you might find you start living in the God's flow, you know. Or I know people who go to the other side, you know, they're activists, you know, they want to reach people, you know. And they do things, but neglect their spiritual life. You know, they neglect the depths of the Spirit. They neglect that. And let me put it as bluntly as I can, you know. Mission without spirituality is powerless. Wait in Jerusalem until the Holy Spirit comes from on high. I don't think Jesus is saying wait because they're actually afraid of going out and doing stuff. He's saying wait because he is afraid they will go out and do stuff without that presence and power, right? Let me tell you, mission without spirituality is powerless, and I'll tell you what it leads to. Burnout. I have spent more time than I want or would care to remember praying with people who are just burnt out on religion, you know, burnt out. And by religion, I don't just mean the doing the church stuff. I mean, you know, mission stuff. Trying to do what's right, but you know what I'm saying? And the reverse is problematic. Spirituality without, if mission without spirituality is powerless, spirituality without mission, I would say, is purposeless. Or maybe even pointless in the sense that you've missed the point. And just as mission without spirituality leads to burnout, okay, now this is a term that I learned from this side of the Atlantic. If one leads to burnout, then spirituality without mission leads to rust out. Have you heard that expression? Must have been from further north. Is that okay, Steve? You know, Northern American. leads to rust out. But you get the metaphor, right? Even if you don't already know it. You know, if you use it or lose it, right? You know. In some circles that I'm in, people will go, they go to one Christian conference after another, they come to one event after another because they want to be blessed, you know, and they want to go to one big worship service after another because they want to soak. Have you heard that expression? Soaking in the Spirit. Well, you know what? If you soak too long without using it, you rust. Right? The irony for me is that people who are all about, you know, spirituality like that, you know, are some of the driest people I've ever met. They've just got to keep going from one thing to another, one event to another, one revival meeting to another, to get that top up, you know. But somewhere in the middle of that, you know, where real spirituality meets real mission, the kind of sweet spot in the middle there, let me just call it discipleship. Everyday discipleship. That's where the real joy happens. Walking with Jesus, you know, deeply and missionally, day by day. Day by day. As the Father has sent me, so I send you. Receive the Holy Spirit and go and do the things that I have been doing. Even greater things, right? So discipleship, let's run with that idea for a minute. There's a lot of confusion about discipleship and what it is. But in the Wesleyan tradition, one of Wesley's favorite books was The Imitation of Christ. You know, Thomas A Kempis. Have you, you know the book I'm talking about? Well, even if you don't worry, it's fine. Has anybody read the book? Oh my, well done. has anybody tried reading the book and given up? I have to confess. I made it all the way through like the third time. This is not going to encourage you to read this book. I promise you, you do need to read this book. But I made it to about a third of the way through, you know, the first two times, and I just lost the will to live, really. It was... And seriously, I mean, it's all about mortification and putting yourself to death, and, you know, it's, oh, my goodness. The third time through, though, when I got to that feeling, something actually occurred to me. Losing the will to live, Phil? Yeah. That's the point. You're supposed to lose it, you know. I mean, in your own strength, your own resources, your own self, you know. And live only and solely and full of him and his spirit. So, read the book. I don't know why I talked about that. It's really slightly off-piste. But the imitation, it's the word imitation that is interesting to me. Now, a little exercise of the imagination for you. Okay, so you've all read the Gospels and had the Gospels read to you about how the first disciples followed Jesus around. Follower, another name for disciple, right, of Jesus. So what I'd like you to do is just think, imagine you are one of those first disciples following Jesus around, you know, day by day, watching the things that he does, listening to the things that he says. Now, as you're doing that, ask yourself the question, what is it that I'm supposed to be imitating? What is it about Jesus, you know, that I'm supposed... Do you understand the question? That I'm supposed to be imitating? Well, just have a think of that. And then just again with the person next to you, just what is it? What comes to your mind when you think about that? What is it about Jesus that I'm supposed to be imitating? Right? Just again, a minute or two. So I'm not after treatises here, right? Just quick thoughts, and I'm going to write them up on the board here. So, what are you called to imitate?
Obedience to the will of the Father.
Okay. This is where I make a fool of myself. If anything looks misspelt, it's the British spelling. Okay, that's fine. Obedience. Obedience to the Father. Yeah. Anything else?
Love.
Love. Okay. Yeah.
His nature.
Prayer.
Prayer. That's it. Just shout out. Yeah. Sorry?
Compassion.
Yeah. Yep.
Sir?
Yep.
Not gonna lie, if I was calling Jesus, I want to do some miracles. Like,
Paul, who said that? Good man! I like it. Maybe whenever I've done this exercise before, miracles are never, hardly, you know, very, very rarely will anybody ever mention them. I'll be thinking, that's what I would notice about his life more than anything, probably. But maybe you think, it's not what you're called to imitate, right? I don't know. But miracles. Yeah.
Humility.
Humility. Yeah.
Authority.
Authority. Yep. Sorry? The time he spent with God. Say again? Well, no, we can put that up. That's good. Say again?
Community.
Community. Yep.
Discipleship.
I wasn't expecting that one. That's There's no extra credit for the circle. It's, you know, it's all right. Intimacy. With maybe a couple more.
Self-denial.
Yeah. It's different from the world. Sure was. Yeah. Okay. Well, that was two, wasn't it? Okay. Right. So, is anybody curious yet as to why I've done it like this? So, what I wanted to do was hear your responses and group them in four ways. Because I think that the ways that I'm grouping are ways that that are indicative of Wesleyan ways of thinking about discipleship and Wesley's theology and spirituality and how it strongly connects with the life of Jesus himself. Okay? And those four ways, let me get to those four ways. So, there we go. Okay, the first thing that people often think about when it comes to following Jesus, let me put, see, look at this, I've got my circle in the middle now. I'm going to have that every time I ever do this. Okay, so it would be this. Let's call it engaging mission. The first thing that we think about often is the things that Jesus did, you know, because he said we should do the things that he did, and they're the most obvious, visible things that we think about. You know, the stories of the gospel are often about what he did, and often his teaching is basically a commentary on the things that he did, right? So engaging mission would be one. And then the other would be seeking growth. Question, did Jesus grow? Okay, I'm good then. Maybe you've not asked that question before. We always sort of think of Jesus just as this sort of grown-up person, you know, who was always fully God, right, and fully man, which of course he was. You know, I'm on tape here, so I don't need to be a heretic about any of that. But Jesus did grow in wisdom and stature and so on, didn't he? You know, and I'm never quite sure whether to make this seek growth or seeking God. But actually, it's both. You know, to seek God is not just to kind of find him present somewhere. It's to grow and to grow in his likeness. And that's what I mean by that. So that's why I've put these things here. You know, these relate to the character of Jesus, you know. And I've included, we could have all of the fruit of the Spirit in there, right? Love, joy, peace, etc. But I'm glad of this one as well, because one of the things that people often forget, or it doesn't immediately occur to them that they need to imitate when they think about Jesus, is the relationship that he had with the Father. And not just that, but the way that he was filled with the Holy Spirit. Without which, or without either of those, you know, he did nothing. See me getting properly Trinitarian here, you know, because there are theology professors in the house. You know, I have this. Do you have like in the lectionary Trinity Sunday here? Do you, where you have to? You know, I have never had more invitations to preach in churches than on Trinity Sunday. as every pastor sort of thinks, oh gosh. Not another time I've got to think about explaining a logical impossibility, you know. There are only so many, you know, three-leaf clovers and states of water I can use, you know, as illustrations for this. I love preaching on Trinity Sunday, actually, because I get to preach the same sermon in different places. But it, it's But here's my simple take on it, and you can tell me afterwards whether I'm a heretic or not. But from a discipleship perspective, you know, those first disciples were following Jesus. And they discovered as they followed Jesus that they weren't just in the presence of one, but of three. Because this Jesus constantly led them to the Father. They led them to the Father because he constantly demonstrated his relationship to the Father in the things that he spoke and the things that he taught and the things that he prayed, Abba, Father, and then the things that he taught them to pray. This is how you should pray, Abba, Father. And you know, and you're around Jesus, you're not just led into the presence of the Father, but you start breathing the atmosphere of the Holy Spirit. Because again, something that I was rather slow at noticing through the Gospels is just the way that the narrative of Jesus's, you know, birth, life, death, resurrection, ascension, etc., is all, you know, coupled to the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit. You know, he was prophesied by the Spirit that he would come. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit, you know. He was baptized when the dove came down in the Holy Spirit. He was taken through the wilderness in the Spirit. He came out of the wilderness full of the power of the Holy Spirit, rejoicing, you know. He went into the synagogue and was handed the scroll of Isaiah and read, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me," and went from there to engage his ministry, which was all done in the presence of the power of Spirit. Read it again, you know. It was by the power of the Spirit that he raised the dead, healed the sick, cast out demons, spoke the truth. It was by the power of the Spirit, the finger of God, that he did all those things. And then it's, you know, by the power of the Spirit that he had the power not only to face temptation in the wilderness, but also in Gethsemane. And then he is raised from the dead by the Spirit, and then he ascends. And then what does he do from heaven? Pours out the same Spirit on you and I. That makes the hairs on the back of my neck just tingle a little, right? If the secret of Jesus's life ministry, you know, was not, as a human being, doing what he was doing, was not because he was fully God. Let me just say again for the camera, Jesus is fully God, and there are important reasons why that is the case. But that's not why he did the things. The reason that he did his ministry was shaped the way it was because he was obedient to the Father day by day, and empowered and led in his ministry by the Spirit day by day, and that same Spirit that filled and empowered his life is now yours and mine. No wonder he says, "You will do the things that I have been doing." So maybe we need to be raising the dead. Maybe you already are, or at least you know that you need to be. Okay, that was a slight digression. There's a logic here too, you know, to go back to the mission spirituality. This empowers, you know, this. And this, when we engage here, keeps reminding us of the utter cruciality of this relationship and living out of that, being secure in our identity as children of the living God filled with his Spirit, you know, to be this. You see the logic there. Now, what's the next one? Using spiritual disciplines. Jesus both used the disciplines and taught his disciples to use the spiritual disciplines, right? If you were following him, you would be in no doubt at all that this was a man of prayer. I mean, not just because you saw him praying, because you often couldn't find where he was because he was up a mountain praying somewhere, right? Went off to be by himself. Spent time with God. I like that, but it's a wonderfully ambiguous term, isn't it? So what about the other time? Does he spend the other time not with God? Now, I know what you mean. There's some intentionality about it, isn't there? Intentionality about developing that relationship with God, and that's what spiritual discipline, that's why they're called disciplines, is because it's not because those are the only occasions in which we connect with God. But they're the ones that keep fueling, you know, the relationship that we have, that we are meant to enjoy all the time in his presence. We're going to speak some more about that. Self-denial might be one, but, you know, if we think about Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, okay, so Jesus, in the middle there, teaches about the disciplines. You know, he says, when you pray, don't babble like the pagans, etc., right? When you pray, but he doesn't say, he says when, not if you pray. Can you remember what the other disciplines are that he enumerates there? Prayer,
fasting,
giving. And giving. When you pray, now here's a good one. When you fast, not if you fast. We might come back to that if you have any interest in fasting. We are in Lent, right? When you fast, do it like this. When you give alms, when you serve, you know. And all of those conclude, can you remember how each of those things conclude? When you do those things, you're supposed to do it in secret, you know, in other words, it's not about public display. You will receive your reward. The Father will reward you, says. What do you think Jesus means by that? What is the reward? So, what is the reward of prayer? Please somebody tell me it's not a Mercedes-Benz or a Porsche or something.
Conforming our wills to the Father.
Right. Conforming our wills to the Father. Your Father will... What if the reward is not what prayer produces, you know, in terms of intercession or petition? What if the reward of prayer is inherent to prayer itself? It is the relationship that we have with the Father and the confidence that we come to him with, and the confidence and his reminding us when we pray, just ask, you're my beloved child. You know, that's the beginning point. That's what prayer is all about, really. Yeah. Similarly with fasting and so on, I'll come back to that, and giving. Fasting, giving, and we might include, well, we should include, from a Wesleyan perspective in there, scripture. You know, Jesus may not have had a Bible. You did know that, right? And even if he did, it wasn't the King James Version. Right? But the Word of God did live in him. And the Father spoke to him, the Word, right? Dr. Bruns, of course, you know, I'm missing something here as well, right? Okay, so the Lord's Supper, Wesley would include in that list, yeah, of the means of grace, right? The Lord's Supper, which, you know, when you take those classes, you discover is not just about eating bread and wine. The reward is, well, you know, it's that the epiclesis, correct me if I'm getting this terminology wrong, because I'm just an evangelist, so... You know, it's that, you know, epiclesis, really. You know what that is? The descent. You know, it's the, when we pray, Lord, pour out your spirit upon this bread and wine. I'm happy to do that. But really the key bit is, and those who are gathered here. You know, it is the way that this practice, like all the means of grace, actually become, they're not just disciplines, but they're spiritual disciplines, because the discipline is meant to connect us with the spirit of the disciplines, as Dallas Willard would say, you know, with the Holy Spirit. The Spirit of the Father. Okay, now, this one's my favorite. And at least we do have one in this here, sharing fellowship bit. It's really astonishing that you're following Jesus around. I don't know whether it's just the way that I asked the question, and help me afterwards, you know, if it is. But what did Jesus actually spend most of his time doing? Eating, chatting, walking, being with his friends, right? He spent most of his time hanging out with his disciples and walking with them from place to place. That's actually what he spent most of his time doing. In fact, the further you read through the Gospels, the less time he spends with, you know, crowds and such, and the more time he spends with his disciples alone. We're going to come back to that in more detail after our break. But for now, suffice it to say, you know, he spends time with all these different kinds of, in these different kinds of fellowship, crowds, 12 and 3. Peter, James and John, we'll come back to that. So sharing fellowship. Now, before I just move on from this, I just want to expand the logic. Okay. So we've already talked at length about the logic between this and this. But the question is, you know, how do we seek? Well, that's where there's an inseparable logic between the disciplines and our growth, our relationship with God by which we grow. This is how we do that. And of course, it is through, and some of the, it's all organically woven together. This is also, right, connected to this stuff. Because in Wesley's mind, when we engage in mission, when we give ourselves away in that way, that is also of itself a means of grace. It's when we put ourselves on the line for God, we are beyond our own resources, certainly our own desire, in places and with people we don't want to be, and we exercise that ministry, and we find the Spirit giving to us what we need and transforming us in the process, you know? And then sharing fellowship. You know, left to ourselves, this whole thing falls apart. Again, we'll come back to that. But again, the logic consists, in fact, really, you know, we need one another, both to... Jesus never sent people out alone, for one thing, right? We need one another for this. We share... we need one another to help one another keep exercising those disciplines, to stay connected to God, and we find when we gather that he is in our midst. You see the sort of way that it all just kind of works together? No tests on it, on the logic, but they're inseparably related. One of the problems comes when we disentangle that and we just look for one piece or another, you know, and we don't actually pursue the whole thing. So, question. Well, a scenario. Another little act of the imagination. I'm trying to stop you all falling asleep here. Okay, so this was the gauntlet that was laid down earlier. So, I want to try to describe to you two churches, okay? Church A and Church B. So you listen carefully. Church A has spirit-filled worship, and by that I don't mean it's... Let's not fixate on praise bands or pipe organs or whatever, because, you know, it could be any of those. I mean spirit-filled worship. Has spirit-filled worship. It reaches out to the community. It has like a parent and toddlers group. It does an evangelistic course from time to time, like an alpha course or something like that. And maybe the people go out down to the town center to feed the poor and the homeless. Okay, got that in your mind? Okay, Church A. Church B. Church B has spirit-filled worship. It holds groups like parent and toddlers to reach out to the community, puts on the occasional evangelistic course like an alpha course, and they go down to the town center to feed the poor and the hungry. Well, I'm glad I got a little snigger from somewhere, because just in case you think it's jet lag kicking in, I can assure you, it's not. I've described A and B the same way, right? Okay. Yeah, okay, so your imaginations are working fine. Okay. But there is a difference between A and B. Let me put it this way. Church A, people get involved in all those things, and other people who are not Christian, or on fringes of the church, they get involved with those things. And over time, those people become followers of Jesus. Right? And the church grows. Church B, they do all those things. People from the neighborhood all get involved in all of those things in the same way. But over time, for some reason, they do not become followers of Jesus. Are you following me? So, here's my question. Why? What's the difference? What do you think is the difference? What's going on that makes Church A able to make disciples and Church B not? Just again amongst yourselves, just for a minute or so. What's the difference between Church A and Church B?
Okay.
That's the last speed conversation you'll have. What are your thoughts? What is it that makes Church A different from Church B, do you think? I mean, there could be many, many, many things at one level, but what do you think? Yes.
Are these two churches in the same community?
Let's go with yes. Right. So one answer can be about motivation. There's a deep motivation for the people that they're getting alongside to know Jesus, which might not you can. Well, the clear reason that I've set this up is to say that the difference does not lie in what we do, right? Because they're doing the same things. So motivation will be one way to get behind the things that we do. And where that motivates. And I would say, I mean, I could take you to any number of examples like this. So, I'm thinking of, in my head, I'm thinking of real churches. And I can honestly say that I think that in church A, where that happens, there is just that X factor. There's something they love Jesus in such a way that they actually want other people to love Jesus as well and meet him. It's not that Church B don't have a love for Jesus, but there's a qualitative difference somehow, it's not the kind of love, what is it Paul's language, compelled by love to share, that there is in. So they may know about Jesus or want to order their lives, but there's something different. Yeah, any other thoughts? Yeah. Yeah. And I would say that when I think about church A's, they would often, but not always, have that training. Sometimes the biggest training they've got is just a heart so full that they can't contain it, right? But I've also been in Church B's where they've had that training. And they might even do what the training says. You know, there might be sort of stopping people on a bus, you know, and trying to talk to you, you know, or whatever. But it still doesn't work. But training in that sense, I think the sense that you mean it, is an important ingredient of Church A. Yeah. Any other thoughts? Yeah.
So then maybe it's the fact of like the Church A is that it's just the result of them living in community with themselves and with Christ, and the Church B is it's whenever they try to focus in on it, they realize they're like they start to focus in on the wrong like the wrong aspect of it, which is why they're doing it in the first place.
Right. So Church A have a deep sense, you know, that they're gathering with one another, but really it's not they're not just coming together as a church, as an organization. They're a spiritual community. You know, the reality of God. Tell me if I wander too far in front of the speakers. You know, there's an expectation that God's going to show up, and that Jesus is real and going to meet with people. And you know, so it's not just a kind of sociological reality, you know, or things that we're doing, but actually, you know, God is real and really present and known in a certain way in Church A that, you know, that's not present in the same way in Church B. Yeah. And yeah.
Could it possibly be that Church A actually is obedient to the Spirit and works in the Spirit?
Right.
Church B works out of their own understanding.
Right. Okay. So you've got a people who are listening to the Spirit and responding to the Spirit, and that's actually their agenda, you know. Whereas, you know, Church B, you know, maybe so they're seeing all the things that they're doing as a means through which the Spirit can work and they can become workers of the Spirit. Whereas maybe in Church B, it's more about the program than it is about the spirit of the program, you know. And I see this everywhere, you know. Again, one of the dangers of separating spirituality from mission at a church level is the whole programmatic mindset, right? And the subtle temptation of that, you know, is that what we subtly believe or want to believe is that if we just do this stuff the right way, the end result will be converts, will be disciples, will be whatever, you know. And so actually what we seek to be good at is running the program. But perhaps as a community as a whole, you know, not having the focus, you know, in the Spirit and in the discipleship that flows from it, without which any program is just a program. Because at the end of the day, what do we know? People are not won for Jesus by programs. They're won by
Jesus
and people who are filled with him. Right? Heart to heart. That's what he would say. So you can have all the programs in the world, but if you don't have the people who are in that, and I'm not against programs, I'm just against programmatism, you know, if you know what I mean. We need to have those people, you know, that are filled with Jesus in those places, doing those things. Yeah, back.
So, I don't know, this might be off topic a little bit, but what happens when you have a community that is invested and they are seeking God and they're doing everything right and it's not about program, but then you don't see the results that you're expecting?
Yeah.
And people aren't necessarily moving and coming to Christ in the ways that...
Yeah.
Yeah,
then assuming that all of that is in place,
yeah.
Then the answer is patience. We are not a patient culture. Jesus was incredibly patient. You know, I mean, just think about the people he had. You know, and to be constantly, you know, on our knees before God. I know that we say that we do these things, but And it may be true, but, you know, repentance, real repentance, real prayer, real hungering and thirsting after God, you know, that that aligns us. And then still, patience. Then still. Yeah. And I think that some of the answer might come a bit later too in terms of how we help one another pursue that. Yeah. Let me try a thesis on you. Okay. I've been thinking about this because it seems to me that getting this right is a matter of life and death for the church. And the answer that I've kind of derived this answer from studying Wesley and studying and praying with people in lots of different contexts. And I think that one of the at least one key ingredient to the difference between A and B can be captured in one small word. And you may not like it. And that word is zeal. Now, when I use the word zeal, what is it that first comes to your mind? I mean, is it a positive or a negative thing for you? It's positive. What does it mean for you then?
Passion.
Passion, right. Tenacity. Enthusiasm, right. I'm liking this group. It's great. Does it conjure up negative images for anybody?
A zealot.
A zealot. Yeah, I mean, it's truly... I mean, who wakes up on a morning thinking, this is a great day to be a zealot? You know, it's like... It's a bit like the early Methodists, right? Sort of waking up and saying, you know, this is a great day to be an enthusiast. Because, right, in the 18th century, all that was frowned on, right? All of that spiritual vitality, that claiming to have an immediate relationship and inspiration from God and the Holy Spirit. Man, you were mad. Well, maybe we need to be a little foolish, right? Yeah. Any sort of zealot. But when we think about zealot... You know, we might think about, like, Bible bashing, right? You know, those people that... Now, okay, I'm beginning to wonder if I have learned anything from you all. But, like, my son, he used to use this expression, which I'm pretty sure is stateside. He said, you know, yeah, so when I asked him, what comes to anything about zeal? He said, people who are always up in your grill. Yeah. Oh, good, okay. That's one down anyway. You know... They're just, you know, it tends to imply obnoxiousness, you know, a kind of zeal and passion, but just a little bit over the top or something. Well, I think our biggest problem is not that we're over the top, usually. Our biggest problem is that we need more zeal, not less. So let's not take what it could be a potential problem, make an excuse for not fanning into flame, you know, the love that we have. Now, when I think of zeal... Two things come to mind. I think when I think of being in a little church in the north of Scotland, Inverness, actually. The Scottish now, they're not known for their, you know, zeal. They're pretty dour people. And I was in this group, and there's this. I was talking. I can't remember what I was talking about, but there was this little elderly lady sat on the front row, you know. And every time I asked questions, she was very quiet. But every time I looked at her, she'd got a glint in her eye, you know. It kind of said, and they, with it on her face, it said, just wait till the break, then I'm going to get you, you know. and sure enough, she did. In a good way, I was well blessed. And what I discovered was, you know, she was the one that brought more people to the church and to faith in Jesus than anyone else, you know, that anybody could remember. She had zeal, right? There's a fire in her eye. I think similarly, why is it older ladies keep coming to mind when I think about zeal? let me go to another little Celtic outline here. In Northern Ireland, in Inniskillen, there's a lady there who's in a community that we're planting there who just, again, sits there quietly, but she does speak up from time to time. But when she speaks up, it's like a bomb goes off in the room. Now, that's probably not the best imagery, especially for Inniskillen in Northern Ireland, but I mean, what she says is so prophetic. It's got the power of God behind it. You know, even if it's just a question, there's just something in it, in what she says and who she is. You know, that's what I mean by zeal. You know, I just have to think of people like that who aren't the typical caricatures, you know. But they have something that spreads from heart to heart, you know. Wesley wrote a sermon on zeal. And his text is from Romans, you know, when Paul says, never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Wesley says in the opening of this sermon, you know, without zeal, nothing much is accomplished, either in our own spiritual growth or the mission of God, you know, in the saving of souls, without zeal. But how does he define zeal? He says zeal is this, the flame of love. The flame of the spirit of love. Remember all that heartwarming talk, you know? Your heart strangely warmed. Of course, he's deriving that language from the walk to Emmaus, right? You know, when their hearts were strangely warmed. But this is not just kind of a kind of you know, mild raising of temperature. You know, this is fire. But it's a fire of love. That's how you know what it is. It's kind of an unstoppable love that you have. When you have been loved so much, you cannot but love. Freely you have received, now freely give. You know, it's that flow. And so when he talks about this, he describes the Christian life in these concentric circles. I've kind of abridged it here, but he says that we are to be, now here's an order of zeal. What are we are to be most zealous for the love of God, shed abroad in the heart. We are to be most zealous to pursue. Another word for zeal would be longing, hunger, thirst, yearning, right, as well. So we can be zealous for ourselves as well as zealous for others, right? To be zealous for the love of God to fill and transform our heart, the fire of love. And then he says, be zealous for your character. And by that, you know, he starts talking about virtues and the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, etc. Be zealous for those, but he says, don't be as zealous for that as you are for the love of God itself, the presence and the power of the Spirit himself within you. And then he says, be also zealous for the means of grace, the spiritual disciplines, but don't be as zealous for those as you are for Christian character, for the fruit of the Spirit, or certainly for the love of God that is shed abroad in your heart. And then he says, be zealous for the church, the fellowship of saints, but which gives us all of these other things, but don't be as zealous for the church as you are for the means of grace, and don't be as zealous for them as you are for the character, Christian character, and don't be as zealous for them as you are for the very presence and the power of the Spirit of love in your heart. Do you get the picture? So he's not saying don't be zealous for the church. He's saying be zealous for it. But there's an order of zeal, increasing zeal, and we are to be most zealous for the love of God in our hearts, presence of God. When you hear that, does anything strike you? This order of zeal? What strikes you as maybe being significant about that?
Sometimes my priorities are out of order.
Yeah. Yeah. It reverses it. It's a bit astonishing, isn't it, really? Yeah. Any other thoughts?
I'm just thinking about, we were talking about Church A and Church B and like the four basic things that they were all doing.
Yeah.
As a pastor, after a lot of years of doing those things, those still aren't really enough. You know,
yeah.
I mean, if we're doing that, is that enough? Are we happy there?
Yeah.
It's hard to be happy there if you've done it for a long enough time.
It is, yeah.
And
exactly.
It's gonna be wonderful.
Yeah. If you really love the church, you really are zealous for the church, you really want the church to grow, you know, then don't start with the church. Start with God. There are many, many institutions, you know, buildings, groups. I say it with fear and trembling, who have the, in Wesley's terms, the form of religion without the power thereof. It's not that you don't need the form, but if we begin with the form and kind of just hope that the power, you know, will be there, then we're reversing our order of priority. You know, we pursue, by power, of course, Wesley doesn't just mean the raw infilling of the Holy Spirit in a Pentecostal moment, though, bring it on. You know, by the power of religion, what he means is that life of discipleship, you know, being the kind of people, the holiness of heart and life, that's what he means. That comes from the reality of the Holy God through the power of the Spirit dwelling within us. If we get that, the church will happen. That's how early Methodism grew. You know, they never planted churches. Well, partly because they were a renewal movement within the church. They planted societies. But actually, they didn't even plant societies in that sense. When they use the word planting, they talk about planting the gospel. You plant the gospel and help people pursue God in their lives through and through. What is the, you know, maybe I just turn it into a question, you know. When you have that renewing power of the Spirit and that hunger and thirst within you, what's one of the first things you want to do? Share it? With who?
Everyone.
Those who don't know. But also, you want to gather around yourself other people who are hungry. So that together, you know, you can strengthen one another and then... It almost invariably happens. And sometimes it just happens that this happens and then people start doing that in the front room, you know. And then it grows and then there's a few front rooms and then you've got to, darn it, you know, have somewhere bigger to meet.
it's a problem then to solve, right? See what I mean? That's how early Methodism grew and spread. Now, I'm feeling sort of disempowered because I was always trained to not use mics, but now I'm kind of not sure how loud my voice is. So, just as we come to a break, let me just run through this. I may have pressed the button on your mic or something. Let me just run through this and demonstrate. So, some very principles, very briefly. So, here are some spiritual principles, I think, that are connected to these four elements of discipleship. Seeking growth, what do I think would be Wesley's spiritual advice? It would be this. Long for more of God. You know? Even potentially before asking, you know, just wanting the presence and the power of the Spirit, you know, hunger and thirst for Him. It must be me. Those batteries were new when I thought we were going to talk about the power. So, so you know, long for more of God. So here's the question. I'm not going to ask you if you've already attained all that, right?
If anybody thinks they have already attained all that, please come and minister to me afterwards, because I'm desperate. My question is that what you long for? That's Wesley's question.
A Methodist, a Methodist was one, not who had, Philippians 3, Philippians 3, right? I count everything as rubbish compared to this, knowing Christ, etc. In fact, I'm going to be preaching on that tomorrow. But the key there, in fact, this topic, the key there, Paul says, not that I've already attained all this, but this is what I do. I press on to perfection. I'm pressing on. Is that what you want? Do you want a life that is... Be careful for what you want. Do you really want a life that is filled by God and surrendered to Him in every part? So here... And a little bit of spiritual advice for leaders. So here's something else that we teach on the back of that. Those in pastoral ministry classes, you'll be taught from the example of Jesus and Peter, Jesus restoring Peter when he continually says, feed my flock, okay? It's got to be true. We need to feed the flock. But there's something prior to feeding the flock, and that is making them hungry. Before Jesus ever says that, he says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. People who are genuinely hungry will feed and grow. People who aren't hungry but feed just get fat, and lazy. They're just consumers. And our churches are full of consumers. What we need, and that's another synonym for zeal, really, hunger. Then, flowing out from the middle, stay connected to grace. I think Wesley would say that. Stay connected. God is present, of course, but there's a difference between God's presence and communion with God. Where we can genuinely say, I in him and he in me, transforming me. How do we stay connected like that? Wesley's answer is through those means of grace, through prayer and fasting and so on. These are the ways that we come empty-handed to God so that we might feel his embrace, encounter him, be taken up by him. I'll say a bit more about that later. The spiritual secret to using the means of grace, to prayer, and searching the scriptures or whatever it might be, is not learning more about how to pray, although that's important. It's a bit like the training question, right? It's not learning how to read the Bible, though that's important. The real key to growing through the spiritual disciplines is hunger. If you are hungry, you will pray. And just before I move on from that, maybe we need to, and we can pray for hunger. Lord, make me hungry. And maybe if that's a little bit too difficult, I know in one place somebody said to me one time, I really struggle with this business of longing for more of God. Until you, when you were praying, you said something a little different. When you prayed, you said, help us not just to long for more of God, but to long for more of God. Do you want to be hungry for more of God? This is what God's prevenient grace really is. Stirs up that longing. Call it an empty hole within, if you like, if you're very sort of Augustinian or whatever. Share fellowship. I'm not going to say anything much about this because we're going to talk about this after the break. Wesley said there is no such thing as a solitary Christian. You cannot make this on your own. Oh, I should have said to the last one, just a word to the leaders on that, very briefly. Quick poll. How many of you have prayed for people? You're watching this, right? How many of you have prayed with people? Okay. How many of you have taught someone to pray? Well, that's good. You see what I'm getting at here? Okay. So the leadership principle is, I think, you know, make them hungry and then give them the means to feed. Teach them how to pray. Those disciples, you know, at some point we're like, Jesus, enough, you know, teach us how to pray. So sharing fellowship, investing in spiritual friendship, we'll come back to that. Leadership principle. I don't know whether you have come from or are taught or whatever. The goal of good Christian ministry is to attract a crowd. You know, attract crowds. Then you'll have success. Unfortunately, an awful lot of our kind of denominational assessments turn on that kind of numeric. Now, I'm not against church growth. I think the church should grow numerically. It should. But there are certain forms of assessment, you know, that then shape the way that we think about ministry. That means that we will start to exercise kind of practice and invest in those practices that were more likely to attract crowds than really potentially make disciples. In order to do that, you need to invest in a few. I'm going to come back to that. But it's a little bit countercultural. Don't just attract crowds, invest in a few. And lastly, Wesley's spiritual advice. It's follow God's lead. We're going to talk about this before we finish this afternoon. If mission fundamentally is not about the plans that we make, the strategies that we develop, the programs that we run, it is as we were mentioning earlier. Mission fundamentally is about keeping in step with the Spirit, responding to His leading and being obedient. So, the leadership principle. Don't just attract crowds, invest in a few, and don't just make plans, mission plans. Raise up missionaries. Help people to see that to be a disciple is to be a missionary. To be caught up as a recipient in the blessing of God is also to become a participant in what He is doing in the world. These are not separate things, you know, but the same thing. Again, we'll come back to that. And then my final slide there just summarizes all those leadership shift things that I mentioned. So, I'm slightly late, but we have some wiggle room. Let's pray. Jesus, we thank You that You are in our midst as You have promised. We thank You that You breathe Your Spirit among us as You have promised. Help us, Lord, to be open to hear Your word to us. I pray, Lord, that of all the words that are spoken, that I have spoken, that we have spoken this morning, that in and through those, the most important thing is that we hear Your word. A word that has the power to raise the dead. A word that has the power to heal the sick. A word that has the power to cast out demons. A word that has the power to forgive sins, to restore life, and to cause us to grow and be fruitful. Lord, may we hear You today. And may we be ready to say yes, Lord. You are what I long for, what I desire. Give us Your Spirit, we pray. Fill us anew in Your name and for Your glory. Amen. them.